Hi guys, this is another informative video just to let you know the best way to use the plastic bottom boards to get the most out of them. They really should be mounted on something firm, and they should have at least two screws fastening at least one side of the bottom board onto a wooden pallet or so forth. They are plastic, and if you load them oddly, they can splay. So if you put two screws in, at minimum two screws in, simple as that, then you've taken away all those issues. Now, as you can see, we've got two bases here, side by side, with different coloured markers, which is really important, because if you've got two hives and you've got two virgin queens coming out, they want to know that they want to get back to the right hive. So these markers, it's critical that you get those configured differently for each side of the hive if you run them side by side. With the screws, when you were using the screws, it's probably best to use stainless steel screws. In my experience, the steel zinc-plated screws tend to crack and the boards will potentially fall off later on. So the zinc screws, the stainless screws are much better and will last longer. So here's a standard commercial pallet bottom board arrangement. The forks can obviously go in here. Now, the key things about the pallet and this arrangement is the fact that there's a roughly 6-inch gap between the ground and the underneath of the floor here, which is the optimal according to all the hive literature that I've read to date. The other thing is, you can see that when the hives, even though there's a slight taper on the bases, I've accommodated that, and you can actually put the hives together and they are nice and snug and tight and behave as almost one hive once you've got the hive strap around them. Right, it's really important that when you're loading the hive, you keep the pallet as level as possible. Because it's plastic, they aren't as strong, obviously, as a wooden base. And so if you can keep them as level as possible, it just stops any odd loading situations occurring. And once these are screwed down, you can have just about as much weight as any hive will produce on the pallets without any issues whatsoever. From the Hive Doctor's perspective, if you're using treated wood on the bottom of the hive for your pallets, it's probably worthwhile just putting a coating of paint or something over the top of the wood, because the bees will land on this area, and if it's treated wood, then it's got potential for the bees to carry the treatment potentially into the hive. So just a recommendation that cover the wood on the front of the hive. I haven't bothered painting around the back or anywhere else. I only paint on the front. With the new features we'll put on the bottom board, the lugs here will stop any inadvertent closing or opening of the hive to a position you don't want. There's no potential now, as with the old design, that the hive can be closed if the box is pushed backwards. So once that box is sitting on the back of the lugs there, it can't be pushed back, it's firm. With this open, there's always a gap underneath here, and the bees will get in through. They also can't be pushed by stock forward to let it open and have the elements of all the wasps and so forth attacking it. You have to physically lift it over when you're changing from winter to summer position or so forth, to ensure that the hive gets the full breadth of opening. Now, during the honey flow, there's another product we've been developing. This is only a prototype, but it shows the intention behind the design. If you're running a single brood chamber and you've got your excluder on top, what we've done is added a rotating entrance to the top of the hive. So the theory being that if you notice you've got some swarm cells being produced, one of the potential ways of stopping the hive swarm is to close the bottom and force the bees to use the top entrance. This way they've got to come in and out, and once you're through and into solid flow, generally the hive shouldn't swarm. So once you're through that risk period, then you can open the bottom again and the hive will return to its normal operation. There is a possibility they could skinny the queen down and stop feeding her and get her out and through the excluder, but the benefit is that if you shut the bottom, open the top, that if they haven't skinnied the queen down, then the hive will swarm, but then all the bees will return back to the hive again once they realise the queen hasn't followed them. During the honey flow, people have also mentioned the fact that there's a very small entrance here for the honey flow. In my experience from running the hives like this for the past 2 years, I've noticed no reduction in honey gathering capability, and I've only had them set in this position, and been picking up about 45 to 50 kilograms of honey per hive, which is perfectly within the bounds of what you'd expect to get. If you add the top entrance then, you're obviously negating the fact that this has got a small entrance, and you're assisting the bees to use the top entrance, and then they can get the honey up into the honey chambers much quicker. Obviously, during winter you can get dead outs, and this is a perfect example of a dead out with all the dead bees and so forth in the bottom. Now, I just want to state that during normal hive operation, when there are enough workers, they will keep this absolutely meticulous and clean, and I have had no issues with bees being stuck down the bottom. They do clean them out. Now, over winter, when you get a dead out such as this, for cleaning the bottom board, I would first just make sure it's moist and it's not dried, and then just give it a bit of a bash. And as you can see, 90% of those bees have come out, and you're semi-clean. Now, I personally have the preference of every diet, I like to make sure that they're 100% clean. So one of the things I do is I buy bleach or chlorine, swimming pool chlorine, which is cheaper, and I obviously water this down and dilute it. This is just water, because obviously I'd have protective gear on if it was the proper bleach. And I just pour that into a tray, so forth, assuming that that's at the right concentration and reasonably level, and then place the board into the water when it's just over the level, and I leave it in there for about 5 minutes, and that bleach concentration will kill any bugs on that base, and then give it a wash down afterwards and you're ready to go again. So it's a reasonably simple, quick method of cleaning the base. Also, if you want to, you could always buy a second tray, put that over the top of the first one if you wanted to preserve the chlorine for use at later days. If you're doing a whole lot of bases, then you might want to just protect from getting water in it. Right, I'm just going to talk about the use of varroa trays, the trays here, for other applications. Now, some people have been using these for flash treatments, and they've been putting a pad into the bottom, putting the formic acid into the bottom, then sliding the tray in, and letting the formic acid fumes come up into the hive, and flash treatment, using it for flash treatment. I don't know 100% about the success of this, but it's something that you could play with. It's not going to obviously corrode anything on the board, so it's a nice safe option. The other thing that we can do with the trays, the small hive beetle. If you're using this tray for small hive beetles, it makes it a lot easier if you use the rear tray, because the small hive beetle seems to be attracted to the darkest area. And when you're doing that, there's a small modification you have to make on these current boards, and basically you just have to cut section of the rear leg out there, and that will allow you to then put the tray in easily without having any issues. If you don't cut that out, it's a lot more difficult to get the tray in and out. Now, as long as you screw down, the base will retain its strength